We are dealing with the last in the series of our talk on the blood of Jesus. And I'm dealing today with the mercy of God and hope to continue with the mercy of God. My introductions are very important, so please listen. You ask me, what is the difference between grace of God, mercy of God, and then favor of God? Are they not the same thing? Do not all they come out of the grace of God? They are all quite different in their manifestations and workings. Number one, you need to understand that grace is unmerited favor. You have not worked for something, but God what? Gives it to you. And then favor comes out of the grace of God. When God grants you his grace, you are favored. Are you hearing me? So God is pleased with you, it is acceptable for him, and he favors you. But when you deal with mercy, mercy has got to do with what you deserve but don't get. And I know in the first service somebody was confused. Grace has got to do with what you don't deserve and you are giving. Mercy has got to do with what you deserve, but yet still you are not giving. Now, what does it mean? It means that mercy has got to do with you deserve to receive something. And that thing you deserve to receive, God decides he will not let it happen in your life. Because mercy has got to do with the things you have done wrong and you deserve the payment. Are you getting it now? So you've done certain things wrong. You have to pay for it. You went and slept with a prostitute and you got AIDS. And you are about to die. And then you appeal to the mercy of God. And God says, by natural recourse of things, wouldn't be your AIDS to die. Natural say also when you're then AIDS. But who suffer radia? Who then mob? Who mob out ye AIDS on the radia then or some area? And you then mobro. You deserve to get the AIDS. But the Lord makes sure you didn't what? Get it. That is mercy. What you deserve, but you don't get. And there are times in our life we need to appeal to the mercy of God. And that is why Jesus shed his blood. Not only that we will have grace, but we'll have mercy in the time of need. Because sometimes you yourself, you know that adie wedie and what it chana eden e media to do. You say, Rade Jimmy, save me from this situation. And then you are saved. That is what? Mercy. Bring me your hand. Quickly. Quickly. That is the word. Move it. Just move it. Move it. Squeeze it. Squeeze it. Move it. Move it. Relax. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. First note to me, yes, sir. Go ahead. Is it hurting? A bit. Okay, it's going. A wohana. Huh? A wohana mutu ye. A twisting ye. Eh. A yasamo. Do this to your thumb. Wait, thumb in the air, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. Father, I command repair. In the name of Jesus. Repair. As you sit there, just move it. I'll come back to you. Now, so therefore, that is what mercy is. You are almost in a very, you are in a very serious accident. Everybody knew you were going to die. Sit down. Come early. Come. This is an example of mercy. You people are bad. Hell, let me hear you. Amen. You see, you understand the message. That's good.
Amen.
Amen. So you were drunk and you were driving. You were about to have an accident. You would have just died. And then you shouted, Jesus, save me.
Wabru awu chika na kabe nya kwansi ase urade gine e.
Then all of a sudden somehow you are thrown out of the car into a safe place.
Hey, what to Africa?
This one is not grace, it's what?
Mercy.
Because you were drunk and you were driving and the car was coming head on and you should have what? Died.
If you say, no, bro, I walk on a car,
God saves you.
And when
you're in some accidents, you see lots of people die, but maybe one person and they are safe. That one is not grace, so it is not favor.
Mercy.
And I'm happy God used you to explain the message. Turn to someone and say, the God of mercy.
1 Timothy 1:13-16.
Who was before a blasphemer? Paul is talking. He says, before I was a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, but I obtained what? Mercy, because I did it ignorantly and in unbelief.
Amen.
He said, I did it ignorantly and through unbelief. So a lot of times God saves people because what they are doing wrong, they don't know they are doing wrong, they think they are right. Like Paul, he grants them mercy.
That is a Paul.
Because as Paul said, I was ignorant and filled with unbelief. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's what Paul is saying. So there are sometimes what is going on in life is not really our fault because we are ignorant and we are filled with unbelief. But the important thing to understand is that God had a projected plan for the man called Paul.
Are
you hearing me?
What's it you're
working? And so he decided to save him by his mercy. And God moved in on the situation.
And now when
to change his life.
He
did not deserve it.
But
God's mercy reached him. Verse 14. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. So now you see something else here. He spoke of mercy that saved him, and he speaks of the grace that came upon him through what? Faith. And what? Love. Let me break it down. His faith activated God's grace. And the love of God activated his mercy upon him. No. The love of God activated God's mercy. Are you understanding it? God's love activates, or his compassion activates his mercy. Faith acquires grace. Can I say it again? Faith acquires what? Come on, everybody. Faith acquires what? Love produces what?
Mercy.
As the Paul is saying, these things work to me. Verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Next.
So
the previous voice, that's what we call acknowledgement of who he was. Mercy and grace belongs to those who acknowledge their condition and their situation. If you think you are okay, if you think you can do all things, if you think you are better than everybody, the mercy and the grace of God is not activated for you. When you come to the place, you know that you cannot, and you need God's help, you will activate his grace and his mercy. Is somebody hearing me? And this afternoon or this morning, we will activate God's mercy upon us. Verse 16. Howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all long suffering. Oh, it's because of long suffering that Abuja Chireno is there. He's so long suffering. There are times you do certain things, you know it's wrong. You keep doing it. And God is like watching you. And you think that, if don't make the mistake, think God is a fool. Or God doesn't know what is going on. He knows what is going on. You're doing it, and you're doing it. You know it's wrong. But because God is what? He's what? Long. He's what? So don't use that as God's leniency. He's long suffering. And within that long suffering, his mercy is working. Until. Full stop. Amen.
Amen.
For a pattern to them that should hereafter believe in him to everlasting life or life everlasting. But the person doesn't understand that the mercy of God and the grace of God are falling upon them, and that they should rather use it wisely. Because God shows mercy. And because of his mercy, when the rain is falling, it falls on everybody's
prophet.
So sometimes, it is saying in that scripture, you fight, you struggle, you push so hard, you use all your wisdom and knowledge trying to achieve things in life. As you are doing these things, appeal to the mercy of God as you are doing all these things. Sometimes we need to come to the throne of God and say, Lord, have mercy. Lord, they you owe so much, and you want to find a way out, and there's no way out of the situation. You fast and you pray, you sought the face of God, but the blood of Jesus speaks for his mercy. In ancient times, when the Ark of the Covenant was there, when somebody even killed somebody, and then the person runs into the temple and holds the horns of the altar. You can't kill the person. They've killed somebody. They deserve to die. Once he holds the altar, mercy. It's to show that God showeth mercy at times. Even though we deserve the punishment, but God showeth mercy. Sometimes we don't deserve what we are getting, because his blood speaks for mercy. His throne speaks for mercy. Lift up your right hand and shout, mercy, Lord. I didn't hear you say, mercy, Lord. Say it again, mercy, Lord. You know the condition you are in. Because any evil or negative thing you do has a repercussion. How come no evil happened to you even though you've done wrong? There's a song that God blocked it.
Oh, yeah,
me back.
He is my child. He or she cannot be touched. Yes, he is murdered, but I'm a God.
David had a problem.
David is no or how be.
He got up one day.
Sorry, that crow.
And he began to number his military might.
Okay.
So you follow Eden. And then Joab told him, David, don't do it. Don't count the military men. Don't count the men of war.
And
God doesn't need us to do that. God doesn't need us to do that. He goes into battle with us. Why do you want to number these military men? David didn't listen to Joab.
David went to Joab.
Went into battle. Sorry. He went and started counting them. And then an angel appeared. The prophet went to David and said, "See, because of what you've done."
And
now somebody asked, is it wrong to count your military men? No, it's not wrong. That is the idea behind it. God judges motive. Are you understanding it? The point was that David had gone into many battles. He had won the battles. He didn't need to count the men. So now he was saying that I have a mighty army. My strength is in numbers. It was arrogance and pride. I have a military, I have horses, I have chariots. When I go into battle, it's going to be brutal.
It is a
and that was the problem with God. Every battle David fought was won because God was with him. Even God asked him to reduce from 22,000 to 300. So David, why do you number the military men? And the prophet said, because of what you've done, there are three things that can happen to you. Either you fall in the hands of God. I kill all these people. Or I put you in the hands of your enemies. Before David realized, people were dying. The angel of death was cutting people off in Israel. David didn't know what to do. He said to the prophet, as for these two other things, you know, if it happens to me, I'll be in trouble. My enemies will finish me. But let me fall in the hands of God. Because God is merciful. And so, let me fall into the hands of God. Because God is a merciful God. God is a good God. God is an excellent God. And God is a God who is forgiving. So David said, I want to fall into God's hands. And David quickly went in the direction. He went to the threshing floor of Arunah.
David, in terms of,
and he said, give me this place and let me set up an altar unto God. Because the angel of death was going to kill and kill and kill. And then all of a sudden, when he lifted up his head and he saw that angel, Aruna said, let me give it to you free. And David made a comment that is so powerful.
David,
let me never give to God what will not cost me. Give him your best. David said, I will give him my best. I will purchase it. I will buy it. I will buy it at a price. And so David set up that altar. Sacrifice to God. And the angel of death stopped. He pleaded to the mercy of God. Lift up your right hand and shout, mercy! We are not always right, so we need his mercy.
Hezekiah,
the prophet went to Hezekiah and said, Hezekiah, get ready, I'm going to die. There are many times people have told me, you are in an accident, you are going to die. Get yourself ready. Prepare your house. Prepare those who inherit you. No, this one with it. People have said all kinds of things. Let me tell you something. Anytime anybody gives you an evil prophetic word, counter it. Counter it by a right word. Prophesy to yourself that you will live and not die. And then appeal to the mercy throne of God. Because there are evil people all over the place who don't want us to live for their own purposes. But me and you minus us, we will live and not die to declare the works of God. Because life is our portion. And the Lord never said he will kill us before our time. In fact, the Lord will not kill us. Killing is intentional death. When our time is right, we'll be gathered unto our forefathers in heaven. Lift up your right hand again. And
say,
Lord, have mercy on me. Hallelujah. There's a story in the Bible. As I end. I'll give you one more. There's a story in the Bible that of a king who was owed by one of his subjects. That's an example of the mercy of God. So here was a king. One of his subjects owed him. Let's take it billions of cedis. Business tradition is our dinner. Then all of a sudden, the king says, go and bring this man. He owes me. He doesn't want to pay. Go and dump him in prison. And the guy began to beg the king. So the king had mercy on him. And he said, you know what? I forgive you. That was mercy. The guy deserved to be put in prison. But the king forgave him. And then when he left the place, somebody owed him 200 cedis. He went and held his throat.
And
said, pay me. As I put you in prison.
Yes, I will meet who caught him.
Ladies and gentlemen, God shows us mercy
that
we should show other people mercy. It's a give and take. That is what the blood of Jesus speaks for. When we receive mercy, may we give mercy. Genesis chapter 4. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain. And said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. Don't believe those stories that people say that Eve slept with the serpent. Eve did not sleep with the serpent. Eve slept with Adam. This one, she said, I have gotten what? A man from who? Cain was not a bad person. But Cain had an anger problem. Hello? It's called, you need anger management. Control. So Cain, instead of sacrificing an animal, he rather sacrifices fruits and trees and leaves and grasses. That is a wrong offering unto God. But his brother killed an animal. Because a sacrifice must depict Jesus.
If he said, for the body, and was a Christo chere.
And he was angry. And so God comes to Cain.
See, a Cain in
Cain. Why are you so angry?
Say, are they in a
why are you so rough in the old English?
And
why? And then God says to him, you must master it. You must control it. Because sin is lying at your door. Anybody who tells me sana misuba intele ubwa, the day I read that scripture well, hello. Are you understand what I'm saying? But Cain was so angry. God did not say there was a demon. He said, control your anger. If you don't control your anger, sin is lying at your door. The fruit of anger is not good for you and the one who's receiving your
hand.
Yes, Abel died and Cain got cursed.
Abel, Ewi, na Cain, in your name.
Are you hearing me? All the anger that you are exhibiting, you are breaking friendship. Relationships are collapsing. Control your temper. Tell the one next to you, control your temper.
That's it, you're trying to say, yeah, you will be.
You're going to go to me for. Everybody can then get angry. Now then, they're done for the door. It's overboard. You can't do that. It's irresponsible. Anger is what? Irresponsible. Write that down. Say anger.
It's irresponsible. Throw it to
her. Hey! Sister. Sister Pao. Oh, sister, the boy fwa. Osei, move on. Mema na minyo moko nwa yiri na boy say. Chai. Jeze. Powers. Mema biso ha ni boy fwa. Hende ne yira sumudia. Ofana kwa. Let me tell you this. Women will always provoke men.
Onka we intro se ma de bia wo mbese mema bufu.
The strategy of a woman. One of the strategies of a woman is to cause you as a man to say or do something that will have something against you. It is a there's a limit to which you can tell. Because when you push the chair, she will push you to do something. The question will be something. Let us say, don't do your anything. Turn to somebody and say, know ye no man after the flesh. How many tacticians? Hey, someone, Uber bomb me. No. Me, why do you have money down? No, I start it. Oh, because I'm not so goofy. No goofy. No, then, hi. Hey, my girl's over bomb me. Then I'm there. Oh, bomb me. My catch the waffle. Oh, bomb me. You better share. So, did you attend me there? And come home. Mine not say. Oh, boss, I'm going to you. Control your anger.
Before you have this woman in here,
why fear you? You will say something. The person might forgive you, but they'll never forget. Any time they remember, it draws them away from you. Why are you so angry?
And then Abuafu,
control it.
This one,
he went and killed his brother. And here is where the mercy of God comes. God spoke to him, he didn't listen. And then he kills his brother. And God comes to him and curses him. You will suffer. You will do this. This will happen to you. You become a wanderer throughout the earth. Cain was a smart character.
Cain,
he understood God's mercy. He said, this punishment is too hard for me to bear. Yet still, God, this punishment is too much.
So Cain,
and God says, Cain, you have worried me. I will put a mark on you so that nobody will kill you. Whoever sees you will know. If they touch you, I will touch them. What kind of a
God
is this? The man had done what God was warning him about. He said, my punishment is too much. Wherever I go, somebody will just beat me and kill me because I killed somebody. And God says, I won't allow that. Mercy. That is the God we serve.
He's
a God of mercy.